All right, Joel, so it's Friday. All right. February 13th, Friday the 13th, full moon tonight.
Is it really?
We live in Southwest Missouri. We always talk about, yesterday we had a double murder. Today we had a double murder in Springfield. Four murders in a matter of like 16 hours.
That's news to me.
Is it the full moon? Is it Friday the 13th? What is it?
You know, when you talk to people who work in emergency rooms in major cities or police departments or fire, they always say that there is an uptick in activity around that time for each month.
I think, for me, I don't know that the full moon affects me too much. I don't really buy into the astrology stuff too much. But, like you said, maybe there's something really there. Maybe it's a...
Or maybe it's a... What does Nate Silver from 538 call it? A signal in the noise. Maybe it's the release of the monthly welfare payments and the other things.
We're talking... It's the middle of February. We're not talking welfare payments right now.
The way they do it nowadays, you get them 1st and 15th. So...
Oh.
Or depending on how... the time of month when you came on.
We should probably just cut welfare checks in general, then, and maybe we wouldn't have this problem, right?
The GOP is talking about doing away with Medicaid for disabled people.
I don't know that I support that, just because I think there are people out there that need our help. But what I would rather see instead of getting rid of maybe for disabled persons, have a better vetting process for disabled persons. I'm not saying there's a lot of people out there taking advantage of the situation of the system, but there are some.
Yeah. So, well, that's going to be in any program,
yeah,
right?
Yeah. Some.
The Navy just censured two admirals for backroom deals. Old Boy Network in the I guess it's a Sixth Fleet, the one that's in Malaysia, Indonesia,
the Pacific Fleet.
Pacific Fleet, and maybe that's Seventh Fleet, but at any rate. What they were doing is they were giving them hookers and nice hotel rooms.
Whoa! Hookers and hotel rooms?
Oh, yeah.
It's usually one or the other.
Oh, man.
If they had just been one or the other, they'd have been all right.
They'd have been okay. Let's talk about CBS correspondent Bob Simon getting killed in that car wreck in New York.
Yeah. Was it 60?
73.
Okay. But,
it covers
studios. Is it Studio 73 as well that they always recorded that in there? But
I don't know. In New York, I don't know.
I saw the lights were dim this morning. Honor of his passing.
40.
What a week in the news! What a week for news being news.
Yeah.
We got Ryan Williams.
Oh my gosh!
And what a touching story of true American heroism and patriotism back in 2003. And I remember I was in high school, and I remember him on David Letterman talking about how...
You remember that interview?
I remember it very well. And I sit there and thought to myself, here's this guy, he has no training whatsoever when it comes to this, and he's over in Iraq, and he's trying to tell us what's going on, and he's in it. Mm-hmm. And now I'm like...
It calls her... And I was telling somebody, that if you're a news anchor, that's your commodity. What you sell is integrity.
Did they lose credibility as a whole?
The network?
Yeah. Or because of the steps they've taken did they remedy or
I think so. See, and the 6-month suspension, I think, is out.
See, I think I would have let him go completely.
He's out of $5 million. And let's not kid ourselves. Lester Holt is a very capable... There may not be a job for him to come back to,
Yeah. See, what I took in all of that is... And see, but here's the problem now. They put themselves in a position now with the suspension. That is the same as acting and making a ruling on what he done, right?
Right.
And now, can they terminate his contract?
Yes. Yes.
Still?
Yes. I did a New Jersey lawyer this week, and the grounds for termination of a contract can be based on breach of contract, and breach of contract law basically says you agree to give us a product.
But I guess what I'm saying is
he breached the contract.
He did, but they didn't he breached the contract, right?
Yeah. He didn't give them what they bargained for.
But they may the two sides have came to an agreement. You know, it's a 6-month suspension, right? They let him know it's a 6-month suspension. He's accepted that.
I don't know.
If you're going to breach the contract, shouldn't you do it there? You know, should the contract be null and void there? Because now you're coming back 6 months, and if I'm Brian Williams, I'm like, hey, 6 months ago, because now Brian Williams is damaged. Because let's say they cut him in 6 months. He can go...
No. Okay, but here's... I think he's going to self-execute. And I mean, come on. You're the top guy. You're your own managing editor. You've got the top gig. Are you going to come back?
And Keith Olbermann crucified him and said that Brian Williams has been like this throughout his career. And he is known as his credibility within...
Oh, I didn't know that he was...
Within the media is very low.
I didn't know that.
And then said that Brian Williams has always been about Brian Williams and only about Brian Williams.
See, I didn't know that.
And see, for me, that's really hard because I liked Brian Williams.
I thought he was one of the most affable, likable... I remember him covering a thing in the Second Intifada in Israel and Palestine, and some guy was shooting an AK and a 47 in the air. And he was doing the live report, and he did the terminal velocity. Okay, well, those are going to come down at about 500 miles an hour, or whatever. He knew that stat. You know, he's like, I'm going to have to get out of here because those bulls are eventually going to come down. And I was really impressed that I was like, who knows who walks around with that knowledge?
The terminal velocity.
Yes.
AK round.
Yes.
Well, here's my other thing, and this is complete internet rhetoric, and I thought it was really funny, but if we remember back to the last... presidential primaries and Hillary Clinton running and talking about being in Kosovo and sniper, you know, getting shot at by a sniper.
Did she really? I don't recall that.
And it was a turning point in her campaign because basically she got called to the carpet on it. DOJ's like, we have no, it's essentially a Brian Williams moment.
Huh.
So.
And I don't know if that's going to get as much traction.
No. This is old news now. We're talking 8 years ago now.
Yeah.
But my favorite thing was, it's kind of like, you like Reddit, I like Twitter. You know, one of the best Twitter posts I've seen throughout this Brian Williams saga is a picture of Brian Williams interviewing Hillary Clinton, and underneath it says, two old war vets just sharing stories. It's good.
Yeah.
You know, so... Brian Williams.
They have excoriated him on Twitter. I mean, they have different memes. He's President Lincoln.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. They have really...
He's done, in my opinion.
His credit... You know, and that's what I was thinking. You know,
I mean, he can go do Showtime now, right?
I think... Or use some kind of... maybe he'll step in for Jon Stewart? Huh?
I don't know that he... Does he have that? Does he have that...
Gravitas? Sure. Does he have the credibility? I don't know if you need credibility for that.
Well, no, but I'm not. I mean, you might be right. And that might be really good.
It might be a good thing.
It also might be a disaster because the writers of that show might crucify him.
He seems like a guy who could take it, though.
Does he?
Yeah. And let's not forget, this whole thing, we wouldn't be talking about this if it hadn't been for J.R. Murrow, Walter Cronkite, the forerunners of... the evening news, where people turned on their radio or their TV and believed with 100% everything they were saying was true.
Yeah.
Right? And when you breach that, you know, Fox News amazes me that they're able to do that on a consistent basis, that people still look to them as a credible news source, and we know for a fact that they're not on many, 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 many occasions. And it's to me, I think... that is proof that Brian Williams can't come back. If your audience loves you enough, like Fox News viewers, they'll be willing to take the retractions and the constant misstatements and the misattributions and just flat out lies that they get away with.
So, quick question.
Uh-huh.
Brian Williams has got 6 months of nothing to do, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm probably going to write a book.
What kind of story is he going to come back with?
He should write a book.
You know what? I think he should go over to ISIS, you know, and just walk up to him and be like, put me in that cage and set me on fire.
Ooh.
You know, that's his next story, right?
That was just gross. Did you... Golly.
What did you think about the left-wing... The liberal media saying that they can't prove that that fire was actually real and that video wasn't CGI? What does ISIS have to gain from CGI?
I wasn't aware. I think ISIS realized that they overstepped the mark on that one. I think they realized that, even Sunni Muslims are that's too far. You now, I mean, look at the president of Jordan, the king of Jordan. You know, is basically, how do you say, he to me is the face of moderate Muslims that is saying enough. You know?
I thought about this internally for a little while the other day. What are the great lies of my generation? And like,
I came up, Iranian Saddam Hussein, but I went
a little, even a little bit different route. I went, you know, Clinton. I did not have sexual relations with.
Oh, that counts. Yeah.
And then I was like Lance Armstrong.
Yo, drugs. Definitely counts. Definitely.
And then I was like, I got on like a little bit of a sports tear.
Barry Bonds, you got to be in that list.
Yeah,
right?
And then I was like, A-Rod. I eventually ended up with like Andy Pettit and Roger Clemens and Roger Clemens goes, well, Andy Pettit misremembers sticking a needle in my ass, you know, and stuff like that. And what are the great lies of your generation?
The Iran-Contra was the first one I remember.
Okay.
The Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North was ostensibly, he was a Marine colonel, was ostensibly working with the CIA to sell arms, essentially a bunch of AK-47s and rocket launchers to the Contras in Nicaragua. And using that cash to buy cocaine from, or was it the other way around? Either way, it was arms for drugs for money. And the money went to Iran to pay to get our hostages out.
Yeah.
So they call it the Iran-Contra scandal.
Seriously, that's the great lie.
That was the first one. And you know, I was talking about this the other day about the diminishment of trust in the government.
Yeah.
I think it starts with Vietnam. I really do believe that Vietnam was the first time where the Gulf of Tonkin incident, where this USS destroyer Maddox was supposedly under fire by North Vietnam, and it was never proven to have happened. And so we use that as a AMF, basically authorization of military force, and President, I was
rules of engagement.
Right.
Rule one:
to you have to have Congress declare war before you can do that. Yeah. You know, and Robert McNamara, who was Secretary of the Defense at the time, and was in collusion, I believe, to cook up this story to get us. And President Kennedy had to have been either complicit or did not know. And for one reason or another, we got intricated in Vietnam, and the whole reason that we were there was to fight a proxy war against China and Russia without going nuclear. That's the whole reason for that war.
It was just a little stress release. You know, we got a lot of tension. We just let
Russia wanted that warm water.
It's kind of like that. You know, you get that bug bite and it's festered up and it's sore and you just want to scratch it. You know, you just take the top off and let it let the air out for a
minute. When you look up until that point, I mean, we had Kennedy here who was sleeping with movie stars. We had FDR that had polio. The media was not reporting. We had a friendship between the press and the media and a belief by the American public in their leaders up until about 1964. And then you start seeing it degrade slowly. And, of course, Watergate. And then after that, you have Iran-Contra. And then after that, and it's just a slow erosion of trust in the government by the public. And now we have a sitting U.S. president who has a terrible actor, somebody who needs to have troops on the ground and go to war with, and the public is dragging their heels because we've been lied to so many times in the past. The boy who cried wolf syndrome.
You know, it's funny you bring up the president.
Right.
And
I think this is a brilliant move by him.
This week, Obama, PR, either brilliance or nightmare. I'm not sure which one. You say brilliance. Let's get one thing straight, though.
Should have cleaned that mirror.
Should have cleaned that damn mirror. You can't. That's the first rule of selfies. Clean the mirror.
And flush the toilet.
If you go
flush the toilet.
Yeah, if you are going to take a mirrored selfie, clean the mirror.
Clean the area around you. What Chase is talking about, for context, is President Obama's campaign, or his handlers, have released a video of him in a series of photos that has circulated on the internet and just gone viral. And one of them includes, it shows a human side of President Obama that I don't think a lot of people see. And he's poking fun at himself. In one photo, he's holding a selfie stick, which is this aluminum unipod that basically you can hold it out, take a picture of yourself. And as he's doing that, he's painting a picture of his favorite girlfriend, who, of course, his wife. And then in another shot, he's trying to dip his cookies in milk, but the cookies are much too big for the glass. And he goes, "Thanks, Obama." He's poking fun of himself being lampooned for the right. Apparently, he's a catch-all for anything that goes wrong. So he's cognizant of the dissonance that people have, and I think it's a Bill Clinton playing saxophone on Arsenio Hall moment. I really think it's a moment.
The question is, though, and this is, I agree, all of the things. It's fun. It's funny. Bad timing, maybe. With everything going on right now,
I mean, you're talking about the UNC Chapel Hill murders.
No, I'm talking about Yemen, and we got a lot of stuff going on right now. Yeah, you know, we got France and Germany basically saying, "United States, shut up and let us fix the Ukraine-Russian deal." Right? Uh-huh. I mean, and is it maybe, I think, for at least his detractors.
Uh huh.
A lot of them are never going to be okay with it.
When was a better time, though? He has been under assault constantly.
See,
when has there been a lull in the anti-Obama...
He's
got this bump after the State of the Union, yeah.
So is it a PR move to try and ride it?
Why not? He's got nothing to lose at this point.
Well, and this is my deal, is I don't have a problem with it. I think I'd have done two things if I was his press secretary. But I've done two things. I probably would not have done it this week. This has been a big week news cycle wise. We've got a lot of stuff. I mean, we've got a sitting governor that should probably be resigning any minute now. Mm-hmm. You know, in Oregon. You know,
he did.
So
I saw.
Oh, he did. Yeah, he did resign.
Yeah.
Well, I see. That must have happened this afternoon.
I just got the blurb.
So, it's been a big news week. What I would have rather. What? How much better would this have been Monday? Federal offices are all closed. Everybody's off. It's President's Day. Put it out there Monday. Hmm. Start it on the week. Start the week with it. You know, and...
Or maybe...
On a dead... Because Monday's going to be a dead news day. You know?
Maybe it wasn't a lot of thought processing.
And that may be that. Maybe it was more genuine than I believe it was.
I would think so. Because if it were for political purposes, you would think it would have been more calculated than that. You know,
I think that may be the genius in it. Is it may have been a political move, and they may have, and you're starting to see this in even in grassroots campaigns. Quit the calculations of politics of 1980.
Uh-huh.
We're not 1980 anymore. Uh-huh. You know, uh-huh. Not everything has to be so polished.
Is this? Can we draw an analogy to the Hillary campaign sexy cowboy video? Wasn't that a good song?
No.
You didn't like it.
No.
See, I like it.
You're talking about the Stand Up for Hillary?
Yeah. Western song. I thought it was beautiful.
Well, this is coming from the
guy. I wish it had been the Wishing Boot, though.
this is coming from a guy that doesn't like country music.
The Wishing Boot was the best country music song in 2015 so far.
I would not wish anyone to listen to the I Stand Up for Hillary song.
Is that what it's called? I don't even remember what it's called.
Are we to the point now where super PACs have so much money where they're just like,
let's just try it.
You know, I think back to like Greece and Rome and like, oh, I'm going to commission a statue.
Yes.
Yeah, the super PACs are like, let's commission a song.
Absolute analogy. I think Cicero and I think they would look at it and go, yeah.
But my question is, if this is 2000, let's say Obama's up for election again. He's not commissioning a country song. Jay-Z, he's calling Jay-Z and Kanye and Jesus and the Empire are gonna go have themselves a cipher.
Can we take a side detour on Kanye West real quick? That guy,
killed it, right?
You think so?
No. Anytime, let's go to this performance first.
Ugh.
Rihanna was great.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if you're Kanye and you're doing live, why are you auto-tuning at the Grammys?
It was horrid. And he's standing on top of, for context, he's standing on top of what looks to be a floor lamp, imagine a fog lamp built into the studio so it's flush with the stage. And they're got some kind of dry ice machine, and he's doing this walk type. It's like you see Justin Bieber do it. What do they call it when rappers can't really dance because that wouldn't be considered hardcore enough? So they do this kind of shuffle walk, and you see Justin Bieber do it, Eminem does it. They all,
I call it, it's like stalking. It's kind
of, you know,
like,
and he's doing that on top, like, of this live.
Think about it though, you know, because we got the camera up today. You know, he'd just stick his hands like here. He'd look like a damn T-Rex.
Yes, and that's what they do. And they hold the mic and they scowl. and he's doing this on top. He's wearing red outfit. And he's doing this on top of a fog lamp with the fog. What do you call that? The fog light, or the fog, what, the mist?
Sure.
The fogger. And he's calling that art, and it's auto-tune. And I think, did T-Pain basically stop using auto-tune? He was the king of auto-tune.
My deal is
and he stopped.
It's like, okay, first off, of all of the award shows that are on, the Grammy are usually my favorite.
Really?
Yeah, because movies, it's hard to do a live, like, actual performance of the movie. You know, you get a little expert.
Sure.
But, like, you get every genre of music all thrown together. Like, you had Paul McCartney and Rihanna.
Yes.
Together.
Yes.
Riri and Paul.
Yes.
I mean,
yes.
Tell me that wasn't great. But at the same time, you also get, like, and I'm more inclined to country music. But,
yes,
Eric Church, you're bad.
I didn't see that.
Stop performing. You're bad. Outside of the studio, you are horrible. And I'm sorry. That's just
bad. Is he the front runner for
He's country music's pretty boy. And he sings the song you like about Shaking It For Me. He's your...
That guy.
And so,
you don't like him because he's too crossover. He's not pure country.
Well, I think... Maybe you're right. But I also think it's just horrible. I mean, he needed auto-tune. You
know? I didn't watch it. Let me ask you this. As an evangelical, when they...
As an evangelical.
Well, would you not? Or you're not... Well, I know your mom is, right?
I mean...
From that background.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, when they enter... They start the show...
TMZ with, says, first Gen R crash photo.
When they start the show with AC/DC and... People in the crowd are wearing little miniature devil horns, and the song is Highway to Hell. Are you flipping out at that moment? Are you saying...
No, because at least for me, and I think my mother's the same way, because we're doing the evangelical thing, is it's art. And I think you have to understand it's art. And
back in the day, there were people lining up protesting that this is the devil's music, and this is going to... ruin our children and...
Yeah, I think the difference is, though, at least, and maybe it's just because I'm older, you know, because I do remember that, is I can look at that and go, okay, they're just expressing, they're not really wanting people to go to hell.
Mm.
You know, they're singing a catchy tune.
Now, I'm glad you admitted that. Let's take it to rap music. When you see a rapper up there extolling the virtues of material wealth and how many women he's got and everything, do you think that has a negative impact on the youth?
The problem I have with rap has less to do with the things you just mentioned and more to do with the glamorizing of a guy that kills a cop, or the glamorizing of how many teardrop tattoos he's got because he's dropped so many guys. The gangster, the hardcore gangster rap that is simply about criminal activity. Now, country music sings about drinking and driving. You know, taking a back road in a beer can. Mm. You know, that happens.
But don't glamorize it.
In the same breath, don't glamorize it. You know,
and it's
rap
not
music,
the same level of violence.
No, I would equate that to rap music's songs about getting high. You know?
Yeah.
But in the same breath, the country music does have the songs about the upset, you know,
Earl.
Yes, Earl's got to die.
Yeah, there are those. That's pretty.
There are those songs, but I think my problem is more with the hardcore gangster rap that it's all it's about.
It's glamorizing.
It's so much.
Romanticizing.
And a little caveat about your Earl is most people that would listen to that song realize it's a comedy. It's not an actual tale.
Mm-hmm. It's about somebody being wronged and making it right.
Whereas a lot of times in the gangster rap, it's just all about...
I'll give you that.
And
I think that's fair.
And I like
I like me some Kanye every now and then. I like Jay-Z.
I have not found one song that I besides the Alimony.
Kendrick Lamar. I like Kendrick. I like Drake. Drake dropped a new album last night.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Drake dropped a new album. So, I mean...
I didn't know you were this plugged into the...
Yeah, you know me and rap music. We go
ahead. Well, I was going to ask you about Birdman and Young Money coming out saying that he...
The contract issues and
no, there's a rapper that works now for Birdman. What is it, Cash Money Records?
Okay, yeah.
I don't know if I can say this online, but he had relations with Birdman so that he could get the deal, and said it a lot more explicitly like than I just did.
Like to take this moment to make a public service announcement. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be rappers.
Oh my! And it is just got Black Twitter and
I'm glad you mentioned Black Twitter.
Yeah.
Do you find the
I think it's
the
funnier
the comparison? Have you seen the Black Twitter versus White Twitter comparisons?
No, I have not seen.
Oh my goodness!
Are they like night and day?
They're very good. Well, like people are putting them together now, and it'll be pictures and just the differences, but. Should our differences be celebrated?
Oh, I'd say it's like going to a pizza restaurant versus a Chinese restaurant. You know what you're getting into when you walk in the door. That you want something different. You go to a burger.
We see so much about racism in the last 8 months, particularly,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, actually, I'll even take it back to last June when the FIFA World Cup started and the issues that FIFA has at the world level of racism. Mm. And so, that's when
Mario Batali?
Well, just any of them. Mm-hmm. Any of the players that have experienced racism. And it's different for, a sport.
Give the viewers some context. In FIFA, in world soccer, it's not uncommon for African and black players from all over the world to literally get racial epithets thrown at them. In unison, we're talking a stadium, probably, yeah. How many, 30,000, 40,000 people? Yeah, can you imagine calling you the N-word?
And it's actually, that word is very rarely used. It's usually more
I would say
monkey
it has,
and stuff like that.
Well, still, okay, well, let's just say something with a racial... A
racial context.
Yeah. Completely. And I mean, it got so bad that FIFA had to threaten these teams that if you didn't stop this... That we're going. What were they? Forfeit the game, or
basically, they went on a awareness campaign. FIFA has for the last couple of years.
Yeah, and so I mean, it is that endemic. So that just to give you some context there.
But yeah, I think so race has been in our minds so much. But I look at Twitter and I see the Black Twitter versus White Twitter. And it's not a one is better than another.
It's the restaurant.
It's look at how different they are.
Yeah. And well, so, I mean, you know what you're getting, and if you can, there is difference in culture. Is there not? I mean, isn't that why we go to a pizza joint versus a Chinese food place? That there is, you expect a little bit of difference. It doesn't mean it's worse or better, but it is different.
You know, I was in Jeff City yesterday. You didn't know this.
No.
And I took a little. We took a little detour off the main route, and I have I'm saying all this to get you into something here, but there's an old rundown brick building just off of the Missouri River. I looked up and it said International Shoe.
Oh yes, that case.
And immediately I thought back to all the conversations we've had about International Shoe and the
long arm of jurisdiction
and what it means today. And I couldn't help but think of
that case.
Alabama's judge.
Well, International Shoe is a little different. Well, International Shoe represents that the, I don't want to go into the whole case, salesmen from St. Louis were selling shoes.
But it establishes federal jurisdiction.
Exactly.
And that's
but not that's not the case on point. The case on point is Alcor, I can't remember now, but Article 3 of the Constitution says the Constitution is the law of the land. That every other court is subordinate to the U.S. Constitution, the federal Constitution.
But I guess I brought all that up to say Alabama's state
Roy Moore.
Roy Moore.
standing in the store. Do you remember seeing the footage of George Wallace?
Do you remember in 03? Because this isn't his first time of
the Ten Commandments.
The Ten Commandments. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he was a circuit judge then, yeah. Correct?
To give some context, current Supreme Court justice. State Supreme Court Justice of Alabama. His name is Roy Moore. He's a, would it be fair to say, evangelical?
I'm not sure. I don't know. So,
okay. Anytime the guy fought to have the Ten Commandments.
Well, I mean,
would it be fair to say that he is right?
I would say he's a very conservative Christian.
Very conservative Christian. Okay, we'll go with that label. On a scale from 1 to 10,
he's like
10.
12.
Yeah. Okay. This is a guy who, let's back up a little. In 1963, the former governor of Alabama, George Wallace, stood in front of the doorway at the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa and defied a sitting U.S. president, President Kennedy at the time. The federal marshals had to come and deputize the National Guard to allow African-American students to
enroll in classes.
To enroll in class. So, just to give you some context of where we're coming from, and this was last week, a federal judge in Alabama said that gay people could get married within that it was a violation of the 14th Amendment, the Equal Protection Act. You have to extend the same rights that other states are giving them. You have to do that in Alabama. And Roy Moore took to the microphones and said to the 72 counties that are in Alabama, to the local, I think they do it through the probate office, told them, you can defy that order, that our state constitution is superior to that federal judge ruling. And that, so just to give you some context.
Well, the reason I brought this up is I think this is the last states' rights battle. I think gay marriage will be known 50 years from now as the final states' rights battle.
I think there's still plenty.
There may be, but I think...
The one in the West with Utah and the federal lands?
But no, and I mean, those are different. This is, you know, we had the Democrat senator from Florida that basically in 1965 was what they said was the last states' rights battle. But it was not, you know. We later learned that now we've got another one in gay marriage. You know my opinion on gay marriage. It's whatever at this point. It's coming and it's whatever. And I'm a conservative.
Why fight it? Why stand in the door? Why be that guy standing in the door? Look at how foolish George Wallace looks now. When we look back at 1963, it's segregation now, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. He looks like an idiot.
Well, I guess. And you're 100% right, that history is not on his side now. But I really do. I believe that gay rights, let's go with gay marriage as it's known.
Right.
Is the final battle.
I don't think so. I think it's going to come full circle around 2050 when white folks are now the minority and they're going to petition for equal rights protection. And they're going to... They're going to dust off all the arguments for affirmative action and all the arguments...
You say that. Why would they have to? They're already on the books.
There will be a minority, and they'll be clamoring, why can't I get a loan? Why can't I get my kid into a good college? Why do I have to send my kids to these substandard schools? The same arguments that would be, why are a disproportionate number of my people being incarcerated or not represented in government? Why? We will see the same arguments dusted off and brought out of mothballs. I think that will be the last states' right battle.
You may be right. I actually, you and I have very differing opinions.
Yeah.
I don't think that'll ever happen. I don't ever think you'll see that baton passed.
Okay.
I just don't.
Latinos, by the way, will become the majority, and they will by de facto become the new white people in about 2050. That's what the U.S. Census says. That's what the Office of Management and Budget is estimating. And so it's coming. And boy, I hope I live that long to see the tables turn to the point where you walk into a grocery store and most of the signs are in Spanish and most of the signs are The music.
See, and I really don't think that's gonna happen. I think you're gonna get a national language.
And white folks are gonna be like, what about us? I can't wait.
Do you think we'll get a national language? Harvard law professors are predicting we get a national language.
Let me go back to the case down.
How about this? Do we need a national language?
Yes. Yes.
And would it be English or would it be Spanish?
It would be English.
Because of...
It should be English. English is the language of science.
English is the language of the world.
Right. Well...
Mandarin is...
Science, I would say.
Well...
And science basically dictates what the language, right?
I mean, most countries that value the dollar second behind their own...
Right.
Their next language is English.
Well, my point being, if you're selling oil, right, you're selling it based on a unit of measure... And you need to know what markets that oil can be in, and that's English. So the lingua franca, whether they like it or not, in Beijing, is English, and I think it will remain that way.
I do too.
So it much like the DoD went to the metric system back. It's been about 20 years now.
1991 was it?
Was it? I think that English will become. I mean, it's just more efficient to use one.
Yeah.
You know, but it's. We have a tendency in America to be very short-sighted historically, and we don't remember that about 100 years ago, they're probably in an area of about 50 square miles anywhere in America. It was not uncommon to have people speaking 10 or 15 different languages. And
I agree with that, but I think, well, Missouri has already put it on the books. In Missouri, the language that is spoken in legal situations, so
right.
Courtrooms, in municipalities' offices, in your county's commission office, is English. That
right.
By law.
Right.
Now, that's not to say that somebody that speaks Spanish can't come in and be heard. It's just the language that the commission is going to speak will be in English.
Mm-hmm.
Or the language that the judge is going to speak and write his brief in
right.
will be in English. And so, is the law that we'll see federally that? Or is the law that we'll see federally... Because, here's my question, federal government's thinking about mandating cursive again into education. Did you see that? It just came out in the last week.
No, I did not.
That is actually a recommendation that's coming out of the federal education planning program.
I don't see the upside on that.
I haven't looked at why. I just know that literally I saw several. I follow different teachers and educators.
Yeah.
And then that they were, most of them were in favor of it.
There's two tests that I think everybody should know. Whenever it comes to a federal law or federal decision, two things you should know. Does the government have a vested interest in seeing that position advanced? Or is someone's civil rights being diminished or curtailed or injured? And if anything fits those one of those two prongs, then it needs attention. And I don't see somebody being injured by not using cursive, and I don't see somebody being having their civil rights deprived because they can't write in cursive. So
yeah,
I don't know if that will stand the test.
Well, no, it'll be taught. It's no different than English or than math. I mean, it's the same idea.
You could be injured by not being taught math.
You could be injured by not being taught cursive.
How? I don't get that.
What if you can't? Okay, if somebody's writing in cursive, you can't read it.
Huh.
I mean, I'm not saying. Obviously, this is not going to be law.
Mm-hmm.
It will be an education standard, which is entirely different.
I'm not sure that's something we should be worried about. I think I'd put my big to small. You know what I'm saying? I would be worried why we're dropping
math and science. You're focusing too narrowly on the cursive. I said all that to say, I think soon you're going to see that English is mandated as the language taught.
Certainly. And I think the government has a substantial vested interest in seeing that interest.
And I wasn't saying... That I wasn't trying to focus on the curse. I'm just saying, I think you're going to start seeing, maybe it won't be a law on the books. Maybe
right,
it's going
right.
to be a law in action.
Part of the curriculum.
So, that kind of thing.
I can't, besides signing my name, very seldom. I didn't even use cursive really when I was...
You've seen my handwriting. It's...
Abysmal.
But it's cursive. It's all cursive.
Yeah.
And that's...
I don't print ever. Yeah. I only write cursive.
I think it's general. My mom had beautiful handwriting, the cursive handwriting. I think it's that generation.
Yeah. You know? I don't know what it was that cursive stuck over print for me.
Huh. I've always been a print guy.
See,
my dad is that way
too. And you call my handwriting abysmal, it perfectly legible to me, but to most it may not be.
Yeah.
But
maybe that's too strong a word.
I think for me it was almost a shorthand. You know, the cursive was because it'd be taking notes in class.
It is faster.
It's much
quicker. Because your pen doesn't have to leave the paper.
Yeah, it's much quicker.
It is more efficient.
So you know, to the fact that I didn't even know cursive wasn't even taught anymore until I saw this.
I saw you ask a young kid now to write cursive, and they're hard pressed to, you know. I mean, they don't use it; they text, you know, and they type.
Yeah.
But I think typing, well, that would be my focus.
It is mandated.
Yeah, that is
mandated now. So
I mean, I think you can probably make an argument to text teaching. Thumb texting.
I told somebody the other day. I think you could make an argument that you could probably drop some of the. I would guess you would call them elective courses in high school.
Woodworking, metal shop.
Maybe some of that stuff. We're in a very blue-collar area, so maybe not.
I liked woodworking. I loved it.
I enjoy woodworking. I enjoy metal shop, as you filmed before.
Yes.
But
I didn't take that one. I didn't take metal shop.
But I think a class that would be very advantageous for young kids would be code writing.
Yes.
I think code would be...
HTML, if basic.
Basic HTML.
Yeah.
I wish I would have had that opportunity.
Yeah.
You know, I guess HTML code wasn't even around when I was in high school.
That's right.
Yet, but,
Pascal or C++.
It was C++. You know, C++ code was... But some form of code writing, I think, would be great.
Yeah.
We're way off on a tangent.
That's the beauty of Chase and me is we are so curious about so many items. Our curiosity and world advance and politics is just insatiable. And so me and him share that fetish. I don't know.
There's some passion.
There's some people who don't. I everything. I mean, whether it's the dog show or the... You know, everything. I gotta know about it. But I'm kind of looking at the big news stories here, and...
I see one on there. Have you seen this story about the dog that finds his owner? His dog, a guy is in the hospital. A gentleman's in the hospital.
For cancer treatment. I did see the headline. I didn't read the story.
And somehow, now, I'm super skeptical on this stuff.
Really?
You know that.
You think it might have been set up?
Like, a dog escapes his home somehow... And finds just so happens to find the hospital that his owner is receiving treatment at. Now, I believe 100% that
how do those dogs get back home, Chase? You've heard this. The family moves and forgets the dog, and the dog follows them.
Wait a minute! Time out.
You've never heard that story?
No, but who forgets the dog? Toilet paper, maybe.
Well, let's put it this way.
A book that you hid in a corner, maybe.
Their new apartment didn't cover dog, or they would have had to pay a $400 rental deposit, and they just conveniently forgot the dog behind. But the dog follows them 1,700 miles across. And this is not a lone incident. It's happened multiple. Matter of fact, I think it was a cat did it one time. Cat in a wheel well.
Dude, you've been watching too much Disney.
I'm not kidding you.
You've been watching too much Disney.
Okay, we'll Google it in a minute. But what I'm saying is, this is not an isolated incident that a dog has somehow found its owner miles away, years later.
Did Ruth Bader Ginsburg go to the State of the Union address? No.
I hadn't even heard.
It's being alleged. Did she?
How could you tell? She's so reserved,
and she's always asleep.
How could you tell she was fake?
My question is like, when she's the dissenting opinion, are you like, is she really dissenting, or did she sleep through that?
Yeah,
she slept through the critical stuff.
All the days. Oh, God. Somebody give me, is Bill Belichick and Clarence Thomas, did they sign an oath never to smile? Or are they part of some secret society where they said, we will never smile. And Kanye West, we will never smile. We will never be photographed smiling. Are they part of some secret pact?
You know, that's not true because the gambler in me, I like prop bets and stuff at the Super Bowl. And one of the prop bets is, will Bill Belichick smile in the Super Bowl? He, in fact, did.
Did he? At the Lombardi ceremony?
He smiled after the interception to seal the game.
When Richard Sherman was going...
Yes. Oh, yeah. Wasn't that great?
It's funny. I hate... I don't want to say hate, because I reserved that for ISIS.
You strongly dislike
that. Oh, I don't like that guy.
But, in fact, Bill Belichick was photographed 7 times this season smiling. So...
Wow. How many times Clarence Thomas been photographed smiling? I can't. I don't know if I've ever seen him. I read his book, though. His book is awesome.
I got a question.
My grandfather's son.
This is one of the things in the Constitution I just don't like. Is the Supreme Court. I don't like the no timeout, right?
I'm torn on it. You talk about, but see, then you run the potential that they could be influenced if they were. It's one of those.
Well, it should be like, okay, here in the state of Missouri, every year, when it, or every 2 years, an election, a different state Supreme Court justice is up for removal.
The chief, or, oh, I did not know that.
Yes, you have the right to either keep. And that is literally how it's worded.
Uh-huh.
Keep him in office,
uh-huh.
Or get a new one.
Every 2 years.
I didn't know that about
Missouri.
You know, so basically, and there's 5.
Mm-hmm.
So in 10 years, everyone will get a chance to be voted out in 10.
Wow.
Years, over the course of 10 years.
I don't like that frequency.
But what I'm saying is,
I wish maybe 10 every 5 or 10 years.
But it's not everyone, so it's only one justice every 2 years. So think about it, if that was the case federally, that would be 18 years.
I would like it where you were forced retirement at a certain age.
Well, yeah.
I think the Pope should be like that, too. You know?
Okay.
Seriously, at some point, when John Paul II, remember him towards the end? What good are you doing? You know?
I mean,
at some point, come on.
We're way. That be
okay, but my point
is. About a church versus a federal government.
Ruth Bader Ginsburg, for the uninitiated, she's suffering from pancreatic cancer. And pancreatic cancer is one of those cancers where it's not a matter of if you're going to die, it's like when you're going to die. It's a death sentence.
It's like 85%.
You know, and so she is on the downward spiral. And I guess what I'm trying to say is. Do you want somebody that has nothing to lose like that making a very critical decision? I'm a liberal, so anything she does is certainly, I'm probably going to be in favor of it. But I have to look at it from just being a citizen. Is that, if the roles were reversed and this was Ronald Reagan who had lost his memory in the last year and a half of his presidency and was seriously dementia, just Alzheimer's. I mean, do we want that guy to be one heartbeat away from the button to have the nuclear codes?
But as you know, my grandmother suffered from Alzheimer's, and I took care of her for years.
And my point being is, do you want that person to be the guy in charge?
You saw me. I came into the office one day with a black eye.
You know?
I agree completely. At some point, and I don't know about Reagan, but at some point, we have to go, what are you doing here?
You're more of a liability than an asset at some point, right?
Yeah. I mean, I think, I don't like term limits. I don't like saying,
what about you have to retire when you hit a certain age?
I do like that. I mean, we do that here in Missouri with our judges.
Yeah.
You know, forced retirement.
Yeah.
I do like that. But you know, the counter argument to that is then that
humans are going to be living longer.
Well, no, not even that is basically then presidents are going to start appointing younger and younger justices, leading to more inexperienced decisions, maybe. But
it's a Cobra effect either way.
It's a young man's world. It's time we get some youth in there. I'd like to see the justice be like, see somebody with a bar number somewhere around like. No. 70,000 here in Missouri, which would have been like 2-year graduate.
No, I don't.
Like a 27-year-old Chief Justice. How about that?
No. See, that's what a lot of people don't realize about the Supreme Court is you have to really have a deep, deep, deep knowledge of the Constitution and constitutional law. I think it's, golly, those guys, those scholars that do constitutional law are the ones that know every case that led up to this one. And it's in. it gives you context. Much like we were talking about gay rights. Gay rights isn't operating in a vacuum. Gay rights is built on probably 7 or 6 previous civil rights cases that had to be decided before it. And when you'll see them argue it this April, I believe, when they're going to argue it, I love to listen to those. You can't watch them because the Supreme Court doesn't allow a camera. But
why? I mean,
I think we are. I think
freedom of information at a time.
Well, it, you know, it's one of the long-standing.
Is it a matter of national security? It wouldn't be.
No.
Maybe we're discussing some kind of DOD project or something.
No,
yeah, there's certain instances.
No, it has nothing to do with that. What it has to do with is, for example, it's Supreme Court tradition.
They don't want people to know that it's more buddy buddy system than they realize.
I think most people, if you listen to the arguments, you will find yourself Googling the whole time. You'll be like, wait, what's that? Oh, what's that? What's that? Because they are talking about cases that they're insignificant to you. And you're like, whoa, wait a minute. How did they get there? And it's logic. It's pure logic. It's built on logic. If this fits here, and then if this is a square, and this is, you know, it's all logic.
Yeah.
And they're so logically thinking. Those guys are like chess players. Seriously. Their logic, their knowledge of logic is so deep that I think it would do well to videotape it and show it. I think that needs to be changed. I do think that needs to be changed.
Hopefully sooner rather than later, because
right.
I mean, that's something I've always had a problem with. Is
yeah, they're not televised.
Yeah.
Federal courts aren't either, but appellate courts, I'm sure. Yeah, that's why we still have the artist rendition. How many people are going to be put out of a job if they do away with that, you know?
Well, I hear Charlie Hebo's hiring, so was that too soon?
Did you see the comic of Charlie Hebo? The new one that France ran? Well done. One of the best satire I've seen ever. It's three individuals about to leave their apartment to get on an elevator. One is Jewish man, one is an Arab man, and one is a white Frenchman with blonde hair. And they're putting their scarf and their jacket on, they're going to run down to the store, and they're doing this independently. They don't know each other, but they live in the same building. And they're going to go down to the local bakery and pick up some baguettes for dinner. And the wives of each of the men tell their husband, be careful, you know how things are out there. And the white guy leaves first, and he hits the number for the elevator, and then you see the Muslim man appear, and then you see the Jewish man appear, and what you hear is their internal conversation. They each look at each other, but they don't speak to each other, but what the narrator is showing what they're thinking, and they're each thinking, oh my God, this is the setup, they're going to kill me, and they're all fearful, and at the very end, They look at the stairwell. They go, I'll just take the stairs. And then each of them start moving towards the stairs at the same time. Then they hesitate. And they go, oh, man, they're going to try to jack me in the stairwell. And then at the very end, they all go, if I leave on the count of 3 and I just run back to my apartment, they'll never know. They won't be able to catch me. And that, they counts down 3, 2, 1, and they all run back to their apartment. And the commercial ends. We can't live in fear. And I thought it was so poignant that these three people from three disparate walks of life had the same fear controlling their actions.
My question, they were just missing one person. The young African-American male with his hood up.
With the hoodie.
Skittles and an Arizona tea.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
I thought it was an excellent cartoon. It was not a cartoon. It was animation. These were characters, like puppets. And I thought it was brilliant. I don't think it would play well in America because the features of the characters were very pronounced. Like the Jewish guy had a big nose and he was wearing a yarmulke.
Well, you know what they say. Put on your yarmulke, it's time to celebrate Hanukkah.
I've never heard that one.
Well, thanks for joining us today.
Is that it?
Joel, do you have any parting words? We're 35 or 45 minutes.
I feel like I still got another good 15 minutes in me. I still got some.
I guess that means
I want to talk about Michael Sam. I want to talk about.
I don't want to talk about Michael Sam. Michael Sam should have never been drafted. He should have never got a chance at the NFL. He was not. He performed perfectly in one aspect.
I want to talk about Johnny Manziel going to rehab.
Don't you want to go to rehab? And I said,
no, no, no. I want to talk about that. I want to talk about who's going to take the Indian guy from Oklahoma for the St. Louis Rams. Brown. Who's going to take his position?
Bradford.
Bradford.
Okay. Go ahead. I want to talk about.